This is Whitley Strieber, and this is a Dreamland video presentation. You have reached the edge of the world. I would like to welcome one of the most special people I know here to Dreamland today. We are in some ways very simpatico, as you will hear. Kathleen McGowan is with us. She was with Philip Coppens for many years. Philip, of course, is the author of The Ancient Alien Question, and we're going to be primarily talking about the whole ancient alien phenomenon today. It's been poo-pooed in the media endlessly, but as it becomes clearer and clearer that somebody is here, it also becomes harder and harder to just blindly accept that they've never been here before. Why would not they have? After all, our entire history is only a wink in the eye of time, not even that, a twitch. And who knows how often or how extensively we have had contact. We're going into a period of open contact now, not today, probably not tomorrow, but over the next 100 years or so, it's going to become more common. And I think it probably is something that has happened before. Kathleen McGowan is really an expert on this. She's been on basically on Revelations with William Henry, and subscribers do go back to those Revelations and also go back to the Canopus meditation in the subscriber area, meditation area. The ancient Egyptians thought of Canopus as a stargate, and that's powerful, that meditation. A lot of people believe it's one of the most powerful on this site. So, welcome, Kathleen.
Thank you, Whitley. It's so nice to be with you again.
Yeah, it's nice to be with you again, too. You lost Philip, and I lost Anne.
Yeah.
And so here we are in communication still with both of them.
Absolutely.
Can you begin by telling us a little bit about what your life is now with Philip?
Well, it's funny. I call him my beloved who is beyond. but I also say often that he's in the next room, you know. I think it's been a little over 8 years now since he passed. Going into 9. And, you know, it took me a long time to get to a place where I could laugh and smile before I cried. But I'm in that place now. And part of that is this sort of phenomenal relationship that we have developed since he's passed. You know, Philip died very unexpectedly. He got ill very quick. You know, he passed within just a couple of weeks of his diagnosis. So we didn't really have a lot of time to plan. But in the last few days of his life, he said to me, I have to do this. Like, something's been shown to me that I can help more from the other side than I can help from staying here. And I'm going to be there for you. We just have to find a new way to work together. And he meant it. And so a lot of the last years have been about me navigating what that means. And certainly at first it was, you know, I was so grief stricken and in the beginning that it was just absolutely impossible. But, you know, as I started to heal and then also work with some other people who were very sensitive. And I think that you've had this experience too. When I couldn't hear it, other people could hear it. And what was happening is people were coming to me saying, hey, we're getting messages from Philip. You know, do you want them? And in a lot of cases, they were messages that nobody else could have possibly understood, right?
The same thing precisely happened between me and Anne. That's why we ended up writing a book together after she died.
That's amazing. I can't wait to read that book. What's it called?
The Afterlife Revolution.
Wow.
Yeah, well, that's why she's here and why I wear both rings, because, you know, we're still working together as far as I'm concerned.
That is so beautiful.
And I can see you and Philip are too.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, he's still my research partner. I'll tell you the thing that he does, and he just did it again this week. I write about this on Facebook all the time. He throws books at me.
And does the same thing precisely.
Really?
Yeah, research partners, aren't they?
Yes, they're my. He is still my research partner, and it never fails. He'll throw a book out at me, and I'll hear a thunk, and I'll get up, and it will be. And like this week, I was kind of puzzled because I wasn't sure why it was that particular book. But as soon as I opened it and started paging through it, I understood what he was trying to tell me. Right. So it's always something that I really need to know based on whatever I'm working on at that moment.
As Anne left here, a book fell out of our bookcase, and the book was very important because it was open to a page that tells one of the great secrets of the world, which is the reason the universe exists. It was that the universe, the Big Bang occurred but due to a single primordial quest for knowledge. And when that was lying open there as Annie left, I knew. Now, subsequently, our relationship is different. It's much more synchronistic. She doesn't throw books out, but they do come. Mm-hmm. And I really rely on her for research. People ask me my latest book, Jesus, A New Vision. How could you have done all that research? And mostly, you know, when I'm with people who aren't kind of aware of all of this, I say, oh, well, you know, I'm very determined. But the truth is, I don't need to be determined because Anne is a really good researcher.
It's really amazing how similar our stories are. And
can you believe we're even talking about this? I mean, we're talking about our dead colleagues still working with us and lovers. It's extraordinary. And I think it's wonderful.
It's wonderful, and I really hope that it gives people. I hope it gives them hope. I think it should. It's certainly been so important in my grief process.
Mine too. Oh my goodness, yes. I don't experience grief, although I will say Anne said one thing when I was in deep grief. Very lovely, and to anyone who is in grief or experiencing grief, she said, "Don't fear your grief, Whitley. Grief is another form of love."
Beautiful.
And that was that gave my heart a lot of peace. Okay, now let's go on to this remarkable woman sitting here, and I'm going to tell you a few remarkable things about what make her so remarkable.
Oh, thank you.
She is the author of The Expected One, which we have talked about on, I believe, on this show and certainly on William Henry's Revelations before. She had a vision of Mary Magdalene in Jerusalem, and it completely changed her life. Mary said, "You must help me. You must help me." And she started on what we have described on our website before as one of the great spiritual journeys of modern times. So we're going to talk about ancient aliens pretty extensively today, but I want to start by talking about that journey and its evolution, Kathleen. Where is it now?
Oh my gosh. Well, that happened in 1997, that first sort of experience with Mary Magdalene at that level. You know, it's funny because when I started off on this journey, I started off to write a nonfiction book about women in history who I felt had been maligned and misunderstood. And I didn't have a particular connection to Magdalene per se. I do have a genetic link to that part of France that I ultimately ended up writing about. I had a family link there. But I was never really close to that side of my family, and I wasn't particularly interested in anything that had to do with Christian history, honestly, until I started researching this book. And I started researching women who I felt really had been given a bad rap in history, and I wanted to retell their stories from a new perspective. So initially, I was working with Marie Antoinette and Anne Boleyn, Lucretia Borgia, it's women like that. And back in about 1993, 94, a friend of mine came to me and said, you know, for this work you're doing, I think you really need to bring in Mary Magdalene. And I said, I don't want to do anything with Christianity. And she said, no, I really think that you need to consider this. And her point was, which was very well taken and true, is that Mary Magdalene actually proved my thesis. So from a purely cerebral point of view, from an academic and research point of view, she proved my thesis because the church had acknowledged that Mary Magdalene had been intentionally misrepresented, right? And that was my thesis from the beginning, that women in history had been misrepresented. And so initially this was very cerebral, very historical. But then once I attached to this idea of Mary Magdalene being sort of the key, I began to study her and then came upon the information about how she had come to France following the crucifixion and essentially founded her own version of Christianity. And that was when I got really pulled into who Magdalene was. And, you know, at that stage, I was Alice. I was on the other side of the mirror. I was down the rabbit hole and I've kind of never come back. And she's really been my muse ever since. She has taken me on this extraordinary journey of understanding. And part of that journey has been about dealing with grief, right? Part of that has been what it's like to take horrific events, challenging events, and transmute them in a way that makes us better people, that makes us better leaders, that makes us better humans. So she got me through my widow's journey, for example. So she's been a very important part of my world and remains so.
Well, she is mine, very much part of mine too, in my new book, A Jesus New Vision. Jesus, a New Vision, excuse me. I talk about the Mary Gospel, which I believe is the Mary Magdalene Gospel.
Absolutely.
And the remarkable things in it, such as God is not called God in that gospel. God is called the good. And how the whole journey, the whole Jesus Magdalene journey, is about that. It is about finding your place in the good, mm-hmm. and the good's place in you. So,
yes, my favorite sentence is, and Mary turned their hearts to the good.
Mary turned their hearts to the good. Now, okay. We have the ancient alien question. Let's go on now. Here's the perspective, folks, that I want to bring up here. And that is that there are going to be, over the course of the summer, revelations to the effect that somebody is here. And if you look on Twitter or anywhere, there are people frantically trying to debunk the Tic Tac UFOs and all of the other UFO imagery. There's a move afoot under the surface, I think, to try to claim that some of these are actually Russian devices. And why would they want to do that? Because they want to get funding so that we can try to duplicate them and back engineer them. And second, they don't want to say the truth. And the truth is too huge. And a big part of the truth is this has been going along on a long, long time. It isn't someone from another planet discovering us and landing on the White House lawn and giving the president perhaps a clear cell phone or something. Not at all.
No.
This is about us, and it's a deeper thing than anyone who is in the front lines talking about it now knows. And I suspect also, since I think their ideas reflect the inner hidden state's ideas, it is deeper than the state, the government, has ever realized. Now, let's go back to the beginning. And I want to just preface it a little more. I don't like to talk too much because this is your show, not mine. But there's something I have to mention that has been appeared recently, which is that it's been discovered that wormholes could exist. And not only that, we have the materials necessary to create a wormhole that could conceivably enable the movement of a human body across a very great distance instantaneously. Now, if we are even speculating about that in the sciences, fast forward a million years, and that's going to be more common than a Tesla, for goodness sakes, or a Ford. Yeah. There could be people who don't just travel the universe, but can step across it in an instant. And I think they may have been here a long time. Right. So, Kathleen, the ancient alien question, can you start with your whole take on it? You have a wonderful preface in here. And if you found finding your common ground with Philip and how you began to get into sync about the whole idea.
Yeah, well, initially, you know, I think the joke has always been that he called me Scully because he was very definitely Mulder. And I was a skeptic. I was not the UFO kind of gal. It was not my field. And I was skeptical about it. I didn't necessarily believe in contact initially so much as I believed in him. And it was in my time with him and that he really sort of brought me around to a new way of thinking. And, you know, the thing about Philip is he was so passionate about this subject, but he wasn't a proselytizer, right? He was not an evangelist. He was not out to preach any kind of gospel. He just wanted people to think. He wanted people to ask the questions. That's why the book is called The Ancient Alien Question. He was always about, let's just keep asking the questions and see where it takes us. And I think for me, my resistance initially was not that I couldn't imagine that there had been contact. My resistance was that I had this fear that if we acknowledged that there was something greater that was working with us, that maybe it made us lesser as humans. And I was worried about that. And that I wanted humans to have credit for amazing things like the pyramids and Stonehenge and et cetera. And what Philip really made me understand was that both of those things could be true. And that was where the bridge was built for me. It was like, oh, wait a minute. Humans could be incredibly amazing and capable of all these things. And they could also have had contact with other intelligences that were helping them to get to this place. And that was kind of how I made that bridge. And, you know, I just got off a plane. I've only been home for 2 days. I've just spent the last month in Egypt. I've been in Egypt a lot over the last couple of months. And, you know, I find myself in places like the Valley Temple and Abydos, where there are stones that weigh 1,200 tons. And the precision of how these temples is constructed is something that there is no way in the 21st century we can recreate. We don't have any idea how they did it, and we can't do it now. And when I stand in places like that, you have to be able to ask questions. You have to be able to say, how did this happen? Who built this? What created this? Because as we don't know. And I think that's beautiful. But I think that we have to really be able to accept the fact that there must be an answer that we have not opened ourselves up to, right?
You'd think so. There must be. Tell us a little bit about, you know, we need to take a break. We're a little late on it. So we're going to take a little break, Free Dreamlanders, and you're going to see some cool commercials that you have probably seen and done nothing about before. But please see them and do something about them today. So we'll be right back. There's a new world coming if we can take it. What does that mean? the first part of the message is, if we can take it for ourselves on our own terms. The second part of the message is, can we bear the newness and the huge expansion of human consciousness that is going to be involved? Can we take it, a new world? It doesn't mince words. It tells the good, the bad, and the ugly like it is, and it leaves a message behind. Can you do this? Do you want to? Do we have an alternative? Right now, at this point in history, mankind is either going to get a lot bigger or not. I choose to go forward. I choose to live for and in the future. I choose the future. A new world. We can take it. Available in hardcover, softcover, audiobook, and Kindle.
When you start to ask the question, it unfolds the fabric of space itself, how it's made, what is it made of?
We're not alone in this universe. We never have been.
Alien intelligences have cohabited with us on this planet for millions of years.
We inherited the obsession from the Anunnaki.
Anyone that still thinks that we're the ones that are obsessed with gold does not know enough about the true history of our species, how we came to be here,
and the conditions that brought us here.
We are not unique in this universe. Extraterrestrials do exist. We are, so to say, the copies of them.
We're talking to Kathleen McGowan. Her website is kathleenmcgowan.com. We're talking about Philip Coppens' book, which she has, a new version has been published with a preface by Kathleen. They were very close, the ancient alien question. And just before we left the air, you mentioned that you were recently in Egypt. And of course, this is the middle of COVID. And I'm curious because one of my dreams is to go to Egypt. And I'd love to know what your situation was. Was it difficult? Are you vaccinated, et cetera?
I am vaccinated.
Yeah, so am I.
I was there in January before I was vaccinated, however. And I'll tell you, the Egyptians are managing COVID really, really effectively. And they've done a really good job, actually. And, you know, they were there in January. People were in masks, particularly in the cities. Right. You can't enter an archaeological site unless you have a mask. They're quite careful. I will say, you know, places like Cairo it might be a little more prevalent. But where I was, mostly in Middle Egypt and places where it's really sort of deeper in the desert, and there's essentially no sign of COVID in those places. Certainly none that I encountered. But when I went back this time, I was vaccinated, and I'm feeling really optimistic about travel opening up now. And I feel that Egypt is safe in all kinds of ways right now. You know, it's they're so desperate for people to come back. They really want us there. You know, they are so welcoming Yes. to us now, because they just really want to show us that it's safe and it's beautiful. The Egyptian government is spending huge amounts of money to improve the infrastructure, and they just built these two gorgeous new museums. And I really want to start encouraging people to consider Egypt for their future. And I'm going to lead a tour there next, about this time next year, I think next April. Because I really want to start helping people to get there and taking a look at what all the magic that's there for us.
Well, if some of the free Dreamlanders finally actually become subscribers, maybe I'll be able to go with you. I've been in my dream a long time, but I have to run this website because it's important and it's the only one like it in the world. And that comes first for me. And my books stopped selling many years ago in any large numbers because of being marginalized. And anyway, that's neither here nor there. What is here is that I'd like to go on now. And you know where I'd like to go with the book? A book, by the way, folks, is a real, really good read. And the reason is that it takes you so many places. Let's start with the Ancient Alien Puzzle. If you have a copy of it, and do you remember that particular passage, Kathleen, on page 33 of the book?
If you read it to me or remind me what it is,
Sure. The UFO phenomenon and the ancient alien question have often been mixed and woven in a rich tapestry. The UFO phenomenon is generally agreed to have begun on June the 24th, 1947, with a sighting by pilot Kenneth Arnold of 9 shiny, mostly disc-like objects flying past Mount Rainier. Only extraterrestrials, it was concluded, had technology that could fly at such incredible speeds, 1,200 miles an hour. Since then, UFO researchers have accumulated evidence, which they see as further confirmation of the extraterrestrial nature of the phenomenon. At the same time, leading UFOologists like Jacques Vallée, especially in Passport to Magonia, and Robert Emenecker in UFOs Past, Present, and Future, have argued that the phenomenon began far earlier than 1947. So that's kind of where I would like to start. If we could go back into the past and talk about what evidence there is, but more importantly, let's try to explore what it did to our civilization so that we can maybe understand using history what might be happening to us now, because they're back. They're not here for the first time. No. They're back.
Right. If they were ever gone.
Well, they were definitely in the background.
Right.
In, you know, there's a crop formation from the 17th century that was mentioned, known as the Mowing Devil, which is obviously was a crop circle. And as Jacques Vallée points out in Passport to Magonia, there are all kinds of evidence from the past that fits the UFO phenomenon that we're observing today.
You know, Philip's motto was that ancient knowledge will give us a future, right? And he truly believed that if we did not work to really grasp what the ancients knew and how they knew it, that we would not necessarily have a future. No, he wasn't a doomsdayer. He was quite the optimist, actually. But he did truly believe that in order for us to really progress and repair some of the things that are wrong in our modern world, we were going to have to really dig into our understanding of what history was really made up of. And if we had the ability to communicate with intelligences that could help us to create these extraordinary structures, then didn't we still have the ability to communicate with these intelligences in a way to repair some of the damage that has been done? And that's the kind of, that's what he was working on actually, at about the time that he got sick. He was working on a new book about pyramid power, where he really wanted to explore how pyramids around the world had been used as extraordinary energy devices, but also as communication devices. And that one of my favorite chapter in the Ancient Alien question, and I love the book, and I'm not just promoting it because it's Philip's book. It is a beautiful book that asks so many amazing questions, but also gives so much information. But his chapter on Egypt and on the Great Pyramid in there is really spectacular. And he also talks about the Pyramid of Saqqara, where the pyramid texts are. And he talks about how important that was as a communications portal. And that was instrumental in the work he was doing, and which I am now kind of picking up and doing myself in Egypt, is, you know, what was happening in these pyramids? Were they communication portals? What kind of rituals were being used in there, and what kind of information was coming through them? So I guess this is a long way around to say that I think that we are in a place right now as a civilization that we need to figure out some things, because we've got a lot of repair work to do from humanity. And if we have the ability to get some help, then I think we should be getting some help.
Absolutely. The Saqqara Pyramid is of enormous importance to me, because the text in it, which I have actually learned hieroglyphics, he says laughingly,
wow,
to translate myself, is, I think, the last text of soul science. It is the first religious text we have.
Yeah.
It's the oldest religious text we have. The interior of that pyramid, the folks, the Saqqara pyramid, the text is on the walls. The pyramid itself is a book. That is one of the most sophisticated texts in the world. And it's certainly among the very most sophisticated religious texts. And it's the oldest. And that is so remarkable. Tell us, what is this? What, in your opinion, is the general thrust of this effort to reach us? I guess it's an effort to reach us. Because I know from the Jesus book I did that somebody was there who was not like a normal, they were not normal people. The woman who anointed Jesus with nard, the man who provided the upper room, whoever provided the donkey that enabled him to go into Jerusalem, whoever taught him as a child, whoever was with him in Egypt, these were not ordinary people, because that man, after his death, turned into a being of light in that tomb, and that is very clear now.
Yeah, great.
Who were they? And the platform at Baalbek, who built it, and the pyramids themselves, who had the ideas, who created the incredible, subtle, sophisticated written language we call hieroglyphics.
Right.
So the floor is up to you. It's you.
Do I have the answers? I do not have the answers. but I'm deep in the search for them. I will say that, you know, one of the things that I've really been looking at is the connections between these civilizations, the connections between Egypt and early Christianity. Is that that's the sort of cornerstone of the work that I'm doing right now, because obviously there are deep connections between those two, you know, extraordinary civilizations and religions. So there is something that connects Egypt and the early Christian movement in many, many ways, right? There's lots of threads for it. And we see that with Nag Hammadi. We see that with, you know, all of this material that has been found written in the Coptic language, that so much of the important wisdom it was preserved in Coptic, was preserved by the desert fathers and mothers who were living out safe, where they were safe, right, in the desert in Egypt, where they weren't going to be persecuted. And that's why, you know, these very, very important texts, whether it was the Gospel of Mary Magdalene, which was found at the end of the 19th century in Egypt, or the Nag Hammadi texts, You know, that's why they're all coming out of Egypt, because there was a movement happening there to preserve and protect this material. I believe that the Egyptians were communicating with whatever we want to call those intelligences, whether, you know, the gods are in fact, you know, higher dimensional beings of some sort. And I'm kind of open to everything and attached to nothing, honestly, when it comes to this. I try to stay in that sort of position of I know nothing. I just am asking the questions. And that's how Philip was. Like, I don't want to say I think it's this or I know it's this. I don't. I just want to say I continue to look and hear my observations. And my observations are that the Egyptians were clearly having extraordinary conversations with other beings who were not here. And that the result of that has been some of the most exceptional architectural, sociological, and communication events in all of human history. And I think it's time to look at all of it again. You know, I'm studying the connections right now between the big temples. And for me, the center of the universe is the temple at Abydos. So it's the connection to Abydos, the connection to the big valley temple where the Sphinx is, and Saqqara. I think those three places hold such an important, they hold so much important information about human history, going also including, and I'm sure this is a place that is meaningful for you given the work you've done in Saqqara, the Serapeum in Saqqara. The Serapeum with its enormous, enormous vaults that weigh hundreds and hundreds of tons. You know, what was happening in there? What was being stored in there? What were they protecting? There was, you know, there's just so many exceptional mysteries that we dig into. I guess my question for all of us is, will we ever know, and does it matter how it was done? As much as does it matter what we can do now? And I think those two things go together. I'm just still in a space of trying to figure out how to put it all together.
We need a new kind of empowerment in order to survive. The technological empowerments and scientific empowerments that we have achieved are fine. They're not enough. They will not help this. They will not enable us to survive. They'll help, certainly. Right. But we need an asymmetric skill of some kind. And I think that when we look at these constructions all over the world, at the pyramids, at Sacsayhuaman, at Nan Madol, that weird thing in the Carolinas, those artificial islands that are made of basalt, big, huge basalt logs. We need to understand much more about why they were made, what they did or can do, and what the techniques are involved, because they are not normal. Right. Construction techniques. Something else was done. And speaking of something else, Free Dreamlanders, I know you're as entranced by Kathleen's discussion as I am, but be even more entranced. Let us work a little commercial magic on you. And please do that. They're probably going to suggest you buy the Jesus book and do it. It's a wonderful book. There's never anything written like it. And if you like Anne Strieber and her delivery of herself, it's all through the book. You won't read it. It's not there, but you guys know enough to know how I did all that research. We'll be right back. Unknowncountry.com. It's huge. It's much more than just a Whitley Strieber book site. It contains thousands of hours of interviews, meditations, podcasts of all kinds. My original hypnosis tapes are there. You can actually hear the moment that I discovered that I, at least, was not alone in this universe. In the office of Dr. Donald Klein so many years ago, Whitley Strieber audiobooks, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, Breakthrough, Majestic, and so much more, powerful meditations, but more even than all that, it is a community of people who are either looking to gain contact or actually in contact now. There is no community like it in the world. It is absolutely unique. Contact really is happening here. That's what these shows are all about. That's what my life and this website are about. It's real, and it can be of enormous benefit to us individually and to mankind as long as we take our part and do it our way. This is what being a member of Unknown Country is about. So go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today. Join us and join, very frankly, the future. We're talking to Kathleen McGowan. Her website, kathleenmcgowan.com, her own journey, the book, The Expected One, is powerful. It is a very, very useful book. And I want to kind of circle back now to your journey, Kathleen, because I feel like it's a very important journey. And tell us where you are with it now. How are you engaged at the present time?
Well, I have a book coming out later this year called The Magdalene Way. And it is, it's kind of a hybrid. It's a little bit of history of her life in France and, my journey collecting the evidence and the information on her life in France, which has now been going on for, 27 years, I think, almost 30 years that I've been sort of on this Magdalene path. And it's also, it's lessons, from her life. It's the lessons that I learned following her path through history. And so it's part history, it's part inspirational, it's part journey. It's really the story of how, I have followed her, and it's very specifically focused on what happens to her following the crucifixion. There's so much material, including my own books, about Magdalene as partner. Magdalene with Jesus, Magdalene during the period of Jesus, and her work with him while he was on earth. But what happens following the crucifixion, once Magdalene is on her own in the physical world, because she's never on her own spiritually, she becomes such a fascinating character. And we're not talking about that enough. And that's for me, the 21st century Magdalene is so relevant because she is about surviving and thriving, right? And she is also about taking her spiritual understanding to the next level. And this idea that Magdalene was not just Jesus's partner and companion, but essentially his successor, and then took these teachings and then even enhanced them further once she arrives in France, once she gets there, this is a woman who almost single-handedly converts the nation of France, almost by herself, starting with converting the king and queen of Provence. So the amount of determination, perseverance, faith that she would have had to possess in order to accomplish this after having endured the unbelievable trauma of dealing with what happened in the Holy Land and everything that happened with crucifixion, etc. She's just such an icon for me of what the divine feminine is. about, and you know, it's funny because there's so much information in French that has not been translated. And that's been a lot of the work that I've been doing over the last 20 years is getting into the deep, deep, deep into the French sources that write about what her life was like when she was there, what she accomplished, what she did. You know, there's lots of artwork and of her preaching, you know, and this is a thing that we don't think of. We think of Magdalene in this old fashioned way where you see her penitent and weeping and her hair growing around her body. And all of that has absolutely nothing to do with Mary Magdalene. It's actually not her story. That's somebody else's story. Magdalene's story is a powerful, powerful story about survival and thriving, but also about teaching. If you look at what's happening in the Renaissance art, you start seeing a difference. All of a sudden, it's portraits of Mary Magdalene reading, you know, and you start seeing this educated woman. You start seeing the queens and the noble women of Europe painting themselves as Mary Magdalene. And that's because, A, they believed that they were descendants of hers, but also they were spiritually descendants of hers. They were spiritually powerful women. So a lot of my work now in this new book that I have coming out later in the year, The Magdalene Way, and if people want to know about it, they can just go, if they go onto my website, KathleenMcGowan.com, they can just sign up for the release details and it'll be in there. It's going to have information about Magdalene in France that has never been released before. In addition to, you know, talking about these sort of extraordinary things that she did to create a version of Christianity that was entirely opposite of the version of Christianity that was evolving in Rome. You know, so we always say it's Roma versus Amor. It was, you know, the cycle of what happened in Rome, which was, you know, all about economics and power and this very hierarchical, patriarchal situation versus Magdalene, who comes to, you know, this western, southwestern part of Europe and finds refuge in places where there were goddess communities. Every place where there is a Magdalene, a major Magdalene center or church that goes back to antiquity was originally a goddess shrine of some sort, usually to Minerva or Athena or Diana, and even Isis. There were some Isis temples as well. So we see that, you know, Magdalene came, brought this way of love, brought this incredible understanding of divine union, right? Not having anyone between you and this experience of gnosis, of understanding. This is all about you and the good and you and God. She brought this, came and found support in these goddess communities, and then really was able to thrive and create this completely different version of Christianity, which, you know, sadly was condemned by the church and was almost entirely wiped out. But gosh, if that version had thrived as opposed to the version that was really all about control and power, I think we would be looking at a very different history of the Western world.
Very, very different. It would be a different Western world entirely, because, you know, the most basic difference is this: the pursuit of the good begins in your own heart, and following after a distant God begins in your mind. That's the difference. And we lost that, yeah. But it's what's so fascinating to me is the pursuit of the good is not passive. Mm-mm. Otherwise, the Shroud of Turin wouldn't exist.
Agree.
It is a very powerful, active force, and we don't engage with it anymore. And she did, and he did. They were married, surely. I mean, they must have been man and wife.
Of course they were.
Yeah, absolutely. Of course they were. And that's why the church, in its effort to turn him into a distant figure, called her a prostitute, mm-hmm. and made those up those stories about her. But they wanted to distance Jesus from us, and the Romans, Constantine, made him into a god.
Right.
So that he would not be human, and that we would have to worship him through the institution of church and state that existed then, rather than engage with him in our own heart and in our own way. But of course, he gave us communion, which is a totally is the most common man, common woman sacrament ever created. The other sacraments in those days were extremely elaborate sacrificial rituals that most poor people couldn't do. But Jesus's sacramental ritual was, all you needed was a crust of bread and two people, and you were in business.
That's right.
Okay. Now, someone has been here a long time trying to do something with us, Kathleen. Yeah. I mean, Ezekiel's wheel wasn't a fantasy. The reason I say that with such conviction is that how could a man who knew nothing whatsoever about travel, heavier than air travel, have made up anything like that, or rocketry either for that matter? You can't make things up that you have literally never conceived. So there we are.
Well, and I also want to go back to the Shroud of Turin, which you mentioned, because I think the Shroud of Turin is arguably the most important relic that we have in the world.
I've
spent a lot of time on the Shroud. I think you have too.
Yes.
And Philip and I were deeply involved with the Shroud, and I've been to see it many times, and I've gone to view all of the collaborating shrouds, the Shroud in Oviedo and the Shroud of Manapello. But the Shroud of Turin is so important. And sadly, you know, like so many other things in this field of trying to look at the world in an open way and invite in all of this information, you know, we're so bombarded by critics and we're so bombarded by false information. So when I say this, when I talk about the Shroud of Turin to the average person, they're like, oh, well, they proved that was a forgery. And it's like, no, they did not. You know, that is not true. It is not correct. It is not accurate. The Shroud of Turin remains the one of the most, if not the most important relics, items that we have of the power of consciousness, right?
Yes.
It's the power of consciousness. It created that imprint on that fabric, an imprint that has not been able to be copied or repeated or, you know, understood in any possible way. And so I always go back to the Shroud and say that power of consciousness is what that's our holy grail, right? This is what we're supposed to understand. Whoever is trying to communicate with us is trying to show us the power of our own consciousness. And we just keep civilization, you know, since the age of reason on down, has put so many blocks between us and this understanding of consciousness. And I think that's a power thing, right? If we understood how truly powerful we can be, what we can truly create with consciousness, then we would not be able to be controlled, right? And I think that's a big piece of it. And I don't want to get into the idea. I don't want to get into all the conspiracy stuff about who's trying to control us and all of that. I want to stay focused on what our power is, right? And why it's time for us to really reclaim this and really understand the power of what consciousness is. And I think that's what Magdalene was teaching. I think that's what Jesus was teaching. I think that's what you're finding in the early Gnostic Gospels. And I think that is what was eradicated by Constantine and all of these other councils when they pared everything down to a very simple set of documents that they could control.
Well, you know, I'm going to send you a copy of my book, Jesus, A New Vision. You'll enjoy it, and you'll also enjoy Anne's excellent research.
Oh, I can't wait.
Yeah. She would have loved to be in on this show, and she is in on it in some way, I'm sure.
She's here.
Probably Philip is too, and
I'm
laughing
sure.
Their heads off, no doubt. But now, let's talk a little bit about there are a lot of ancient aliens theories that are very negative, that, you know, that the archons were enslaved us, and the strange fixation on, and I think it's a strange fixation that they created a race of slaves to mine gold and all of that. And I'm not seeing that exactly. I think our world would be very different if that had actually happened.
I am not a supporter of that theory in any way, and either was Philip. And Philip was really determined to stay in a place of positivity, not in a naive way, but in a place of saying he just never bought the idea that we were a slave race. I don't buy that idea. I think it's a really unfortunate way to look at the world. It doesn't really leave us a lot of opportunity if we look at it that way, right? So it almost,
well, if we were a slave race, we clearly got out of the got out of the paddock somehow or another,
I would think. I think the story enslaves us, doesn't it? Like, if we accept that story, then we've already enslaved our consciousness by saying we're trapped. And that's just not a place that I can ever go to. And Philip was very much the same. I mean, he really wanted to stay focused on, let's look at the positive side of what contact is, which is not to say that he didn't investigate abductions and that he wasn't interested in people's stories. It's just that he really wanted to focus on this idea of connecting intelligences and raising consciousness. You know, that was really his focus, and mine as well. So I'd much rather stay in that place of, we have been able to create extraordinary things as humanity over the course of our time on this planet, and clearly we didn't do this alone. The last thing that Philip and I were working on when he got sick, our sort of last big adventure together, was in Bosnia, where we were working with Dr. Sam Osmanagic on the Bosnian pyramids. The Bosnian pyramids open up an entirely new chapter of what all of this can mean, because in terms of their age and their size, they're extraordinary, and essentially they're impossible, right? And yet there they are. So, you know,
why are they impossible?
Because of their size. It's just the carbon dating on the organic material goes back 26,000 years, in some cases 30,000. The pyramid of the sun is larger than the Great Pyramid. I mean, the mass of this discovery, which still a lot of people are very skeptical about, and usually
why aren't you? What about the pyramids makes you feel that they're constructions?
Oh, well, first of all, I've spent a lot of time in them, and I've spent a lot of time in Bosnia, and I would definitely invite people who are interested in this subject but skeptical to go and spend some time there. Now, Philip was the first international journalist to write about the Bosnian pyramids back in 2005, immediately after Sam announced the discovery. And as a result, he became very close to the ongoing work and archaeology that's happening there. And he was deeply involved in it for the next 7 years prior to his death. And so as a result, I was privy to a lot of the academic information that came through, it's 130 different academic institutions have now been involved in doing all kinds of studies on Bosnia. And it's really exceptional, but people are afraid of it. You know, people are, including the Egyptians, are really, really afraid of the Bosnian discovery, because if it's real, and I believe with all my heart that it is. I mean, it is clearly man-made when you're there, and these miles and miles of tunnels, labyrinthine tunnels that run underneath them. It's such an exquisite and extraordinary place. And the energy there is unlike anything I've ever experienced anywhere in the world. But the sheer size and accomplishment of an age of what this pyramid structure could mean to human history is really, really scary to historians. And as a result, the skeptics have really made it hard for Sam to get his information out there. But I really encourage people, you know, don't stop Wikipedia. Wikipedia is not going to give you, you know, the in-depth information that you need. You need to really, you know, go onto YouTube, find videos by Dr. Sam Osmanagic, start doing your own investigation into this material.
Can you just hold a moment and spell his name for
sure.
us?
Sure. Osmanagic is Osmanagic. And if you just put in Dr. Sam or Dr. Samir, Samir, Bosnian pyramids in a Google search, they're going to come up.
Okay. So it's Dr. Sam, Bosnian pyramids, yes. Folks in Google, and you'll get there.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because he's got a lot of really, really great videos out there where he lays out the evidence, and it's not only valuable, it's necessary. If you care about the subject matter, you have to care about what's happening in Bosnia, because it really opens everything up to a whole new level in terms of what we're capable of.
Okay, we have reached just about the end of the first hour, Free Dreamlanders, and you're going to go bye-bye now. The subscribers are going to go deeper into this, and this is a time when if you don't go deeper, you're not there at all. And this huge website, Unknown Country, is a gigantic treasure trove of information that is not like what you're going to get in the conventional media. Information like this, like what Kathleen just told you, that can change your whole idea of who you are and transform you into something bigger. We are told endlessly by the world around us, you're little, you're unimportant, and you're nothing. And has a response to that, which is, each of us is all we have. And that makes you very important to somebody. You know who? You. So get with it. Get on the site. You're hungry for this, or you wouldn't be listening to this. Go to Unknown Country and get going and dig into this. There's so much rich Kathleen McGowan material on there and Philip Coppens material, just to name a couple. You can get so deeply. You can find out her journey toward the Magdalene in a perfectly glorious interview she did with William Henry. So there's so much there. Okay, now, subscribers, we're going to go deeper into some of the actual artifactual evidence of what was there and try to take a look at the why. What is the meaning of this long contact that we have had with beings from some other level or reality or even planet? And why is it changing again now? Free Dreamlanders, thank you so much for being with us. Our guest has been Kathleen McGowan. We are talking about the ancient alien question. She has got a new book coming out I'm terribly excited about. You can get started with Kathleen by getting The Expected One. You can link to both books through unknowncountry.com. And don't forget to subscribe to this YouTube channel. So the channel does not get monetized by YouTube for reasons that have to do with YouTube, but I'd like more people listening here. I think it's important. So thank you very much for being with us, folks.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.